Looking at the Markets with David Modell. Welcome to Looking at the Markets with David Modell. Today I will be joined by special guest Mr. Adam Collins. Mr. Collins took an internship at a hedge fund way back in college, and his job was to interpret the COT, and that's the Commitment of Traders Data. He then opened up a firm called Movement Capital, hence the name Movement Capital, and that can be located on the web at www.movement.capital. He also has several other websites, which we will talk about today, in addition to how the market's going to be doing, and perhaps we'll dive into precious metals and the dollar. Mr. Adam Collins, thank you so much for joining me today on Looking at the Markets.
Yeah, it's a pleasure, David. I enjoy the videos. I'm glad to be part of it.
Oh, wow, that's great, and I've always enjoyed your work. So let's talk about this crazy market we have today. My goodness. I wanted to get your current outlook on the S&P 500 specifically. How do you see it now?
Yeah, so I'll tell you about sort of my S&P framework. Everybody is, you know, constantly exposed to data on the S&P. And, you know, I would read something like, this survey says investors are extremely bearish, it's historically paid to, you know, increase exposure here, or something like, you know, a recent retail sales number beat expectations, that's good for stocks. So I would always see, you know, these one-off data releases and data reports, and I got tired of them because I knew they were so one-dimensional and they only focused on a single variable. So when I read about one data point, I knew you had to include other stuff like market technicals, if economic data was coming in weak or strong. So one of the websites aggregates all that stuff together. And here's how it's organized. It's got four main categories: technicals, sentiment, interest rates, and macro. Technicals are stuff like market trend, seasonality, if buyback programs are active. Sentiment is both soft survey data and hard data like put call ratios and the VIX futures curve. The rates page shows what's going on with the treasury yield curve and high yield spreads. And then finally, there's the macro page that covers a bunch of economic indicators. And how it works is each indicator I cover has a cutoff filter. It's a simple level where you either do or do not have exposure to the S&P. So for example, on the macro page, the cutoff filter for retail sales growth is 0%. And the model shows the historical performance of a buy and hold S&P versus only having long exposure if annual growth in retail sales is greater than 0%. And so I have similar cutoff filters for each variable. The last page on the website is by far the most important. Depending on if an indicator is above or below its cutoff filter, the indicator gets a score of 1 or 0, 1 for invested, 0 for not. All 22 scores are averaged together, so you get one big composite score. And this composite score dictates overall S&P exposure. So if it's high, you know, a ton of indicators are healthy and flashing green, so be long stocks. If it's low, the opposite is true, so either reduce or remove equity exposure. And this composite model is rebalanced weekly. So right now, here's sort of what it says. The composite model is long, and it's because technicals are fairly strong, interest rates are not flashing a red light, and macro data is really healthy. The one negative is sentiment, and so which you probably could guess by the super low, you know, VIX readings. But sentiment alone is not, at least in my opinion, reason enough to pull exposure. I would need to see, you know, technicals to deteriorate or macro data turn south. So right now, that's sort of how I'm looking at the S&P. Is a lot of stuff is flash and go, with the caveat of sentiment is just extremely optimistic.
Interesting. All right, I wanted to talk about commodities because I love to talk about gold, silver. Wanted to talk about precious metals. What is your outlook on that?
So yeah, so sort of like, you know, I've got that approach for looking at stocks and taking a big sort of 30,000 foot view. I do the same stuff with commodities. So when I'm examining a commodity, I like to look at four things: positioning, seasonality, term structure, and technicals. So here's what I keep track of for each. With positioning, the CFTC, which is basically, you've got the SEC that regulates the stock market, the CFTC regulates the commodity market. And each week, they put out this report called the COT report. And all it does is outline how different types of traders are positioned in the futures markets. And so it's really useful, but the issue is that the report gets released, it's like this huge Excel file, you really can't make sense of it. But What you need to know is that there are two main types of traders, speculators and commercials. So speculators are like hedge funds and mutual funds, and commercials are the actual producers and users of a commodity. So here's how I make sense of the COT report, because like I said, in its native format, it's tough. You can't just look at one weekly COT report in isolation. So for example, let's say you go to the website right now and you see that, hey, commercials are net short 20,000 contracts of platinum futures. The issue is that doesn't really tell you anything. You need to know how they've been positioned in the past. So in that example, if over the past 5 years, commercials have never been, you know, that net short of platinum futures before, as in it's a huge number, that tells you something. And so that says that commercials are extremely short relative to the past, and a big commercial short in commodity futures always means that producers are selling contracts to lock in current prices for their future inventory. So AKA, they think prices are really high, they want to lock them in. So I always like to keep track of both how commercials and speculators are positioned. That's sort of the first thing, positioning. Second thing, seasonality. So that's a lot simpler. And I give sort of less weight to it, but all seasonality is just a commodity's average price performance for a given portion of the year. So for example, you know, if the best month of the year for gold futures is August. The last two things are technicals and term structure. So the easiest technical metric for commodity futures is price momentum. So if a commodity has gone up over the past, you know, 6 or 12 months, it's more likely than not to keep going up. So you want to be biased long commodities that have positive price momentum, and buy short for stuff with negative price momentum. And the final element is term structure. So all this is the shape of the futures curve. So if contracts further out in time are more expensive than closer contracts, the commodity is called in contango. If the opposite is true, it's called in backwardation. So all else equal, contracts in contango are difficult for longs to maintain exposure to, because they constantly have to roll their exposure forward. And every time they do, they have to buy the higher price contract. Right. So this eats into their position, and it's similar to what happens in the VIX complex. So in a nutshell, positioning, seasonality, term structure, technicals. So how do those things look for precious metals right now? So positioning wise, one stands out more than any other, platinum. Platinum is the most heavily shorted precious metal by traders by far. Traders are much more long palladium, and positioning is sort of mixed in gold and silver. So traders have taken off some long exposure over the past couple weeks in those two. But what's really interesting in gold positioning, and this surprises everybody when I tell them it, is that gold producers, gold miners, are currently more net short gold than they were last summer when the price was a good bit higher. You would not expect that. You would think that as gold dropped, you know, miners would get less bearish. Sure. And so positioning-wise, platinum stands out. With seasonality, gold has the best seasonal outlook, because of all the four precious metals, gold is by far the biggest, you know, safe haven of the four, and it's typically risen in the late summer months when volatility tends to pick up. Technically, palladium is the only metal with positive price momentum. The other three have gone down over the past 12 months. So overall, sort of if you're looking at precious metals, traders are super short platinum. Gold has the best seasonal outlook for the rest of the year, and palladium's technicals are the best. So that's sort of precious metals in a nutshell.
Got it. I like it. Very good, sir. And I want to talk about the dollar.
Yeah.
You know, the dollar's been getting hammered in 2017 so far. Today it went down. As soon as the Fed opens their mouth, it seems to go down every single time. So what is your outlook on currencies, and specifically the U.S. dollar?
Yeah, so the one really interesting thing about currencies right now is how people are positioned in them. So I have not seen traders this extremely long so many different foreign currencies at the same time. They haven't had this big of a net long position in Euro futures and Mexican peso futures in 5 years. So it's a huge long position. And then behind those two contracts, the Australian dollar and the New Zealand dollar are also really crowded on the long side. So yeah, it's very much a consensus trade to be long foreign currencies and short the US dollar. But it's really important to note this. Extreme positioning should never be, you know, your sole indicator to get into a trade. So think about it. Right now, a lot of people are long the euro. They have no incentive to sell as long as the euro, you know, keeps rising. But if 3 months from now, let's say positioning is still the same and everybody's long, and let's say the euro starts to break down technically, it starts to, you know, come down, then you sort of have like a fire in the theater situation of where you have a lot of people rushing for the exits at the same time. Yeah. And whenever you combine like crowded positioning with, you know, technicals that diverge, you typically get really, really big price moves. And so I'll reserve judgment on, you know, thinking that the dollar will bounce. But what get me super interested is if positioning remains stretched and some of the foreign currencies would start to reverse, that gets really interesting to me. So overall, I know we covered a lot, but sort of to conclude, people are betting on a weaker US dollar, big consensus trade. I outlined some, you know, key commodity metrics to keep track of. And then finally with the S&P, I just think it's super important to look at multiple dimensions and not just one angle. And all the websites I talked about, they're completely free, and your listeners can always email me or, you know, talk to me on StockTwits if they ever have any questions.
Sure, and I want to get to that. You're doing so much research at Movement Capital. You do the research so I don't have to. And which I appreciate as a retail trader, and most of my audience is retail traders and investors. So if people want to tap into your wisdom and insight and find your stuff, how can they do that?
Yeah, so, you know, if people are interested in positioning stuff, the COT website is freecotdata.com. If people want to look at seasonality stuff, that website is commoditieseasonality.com. And then finally, that S&P model I talked about is simplestockmodel.com. And all of them are free, and I wanted to put them out there because, I don't know, retail traders, they don't have the information edge that people with, you know, like a Bloomberg have. And I think more objective data and less sort of, you know, narrative subjective stuff is going to make for retail traders being better equipped.
Right. Absolutely. So if a Bloomberg terminal is not necessarily within somebody's budget, perhaps Movement Capital is the way to go. I would say so. What I will do is I will put all of these links in the description once again.
Awesome.
Yeah, www.movement.capital, freecotdata.com, simplestockmodel.com, commoditieseasonality.com. I understand on StockTwits and Twitter. At Twitter, you're @movement_cap. And
yep.
Remind me of the StockTwits again. Is it the same thing?
I'm pretty sure it's the exact same, yeah.
Yeah, I believe so. Why not check out Mr. Adam Collins on Twitter and StockTwits for both the free content as well as the websites to see what he's got, which is quite a lot of research and due diligence. Mr. Adam Collins, you've given me so much to think about today, so much to process in such a short time. Wow, I like it, though. That's okay. Thank you so much, Mr. Adam Collins, for joining me. You're well on Looking at the Markets. You're welcome back anytime, sir.
Thanks a ton, David. I enjoyed it.
Thank you for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe. And I'll see you next time.